The bill that's being introduced by Deputy Clare Daly, it's part of unfinished business from the bill that was debated here in June 2013. There was much discussion then and a vote on an amendment which would have included provision for a termination in Ireland in the cases of fatal fetal orbital abnormality. What's being discussed here today, it's about very tragic and very sad cases where women, where parents are told that the fetus, the baby in the womb, does not have a chance of surviving outside the womb. As far as I'm concerned, this bill has a very narrow remit. It's not about abortion on demand, it's about very specific cases. Any parent expecting a child and then told of a fatal complication with the pregnancy is undoubtedly heartbreaking, harrowing and unbearably sad. Fatal complications does not mean a disability, mental or physical. It does not mean Down syndrome or the possibility of autism or a visual impairment or a hearing impairment. Because if the term fatal complication included any of the above, I would not be supporting the bill. I do support the right of the unborn to be born. But a pregnancy where the medical opinion and facts show that there's no chance of life outside the womb, there should be a right to a termination in this country and not have the additional stress and expense of travelling abroad. I think it's when we know someone who has had that heartbreaking news broken to them that there was a diagnosis of fatal fetal abnormality, and the joy of being pregnant, of looking forward to the birth, of buying the baby clothes and the pram and thinking of names, and then being given a picture of the scan and being told the medical facts that the unborn will not survive outside the womb. The devastation then, and then the choices: carry the unborn to full term, possibility of miscarrying in the meantime, or travel to the UK for a termination with all that entails. Can constitutional protection be afforded to a fetus which does not have the capacity to be born alive? Mr. Chief Justice Murray, in a case, found that the fertilisation of the ovum is the first step in procreation process, and to extend constitutional protection is to assume the capacity to be born. And if this is not the case, as in the situation with a fetus found to be suffering from a fatal abnormality, well, the lack of a capacity to be born as such changes the rights of the fetus in relation to the mother. What we're seeing from cases before the courts is that they're indicating that the original legislation is not comprehensive. It's not allowing for certain cases, and so it's going to require a brave and a forward-looking government to lead with amendments to repair unintended deficiencies in current legislation. Looking at the argument that it's constitutionally inappropriate to place the rights of the unborn on an equal footing with the rights of the mother when the fetus is found to be unviable. From their report on those who are drafting the legislation, they make the point in their legal argument that, and I quote, "We argue that fetuses suffering from fatal fetal abnormalities constitute an exception to the prohibition on termination of pregnancy under Article 40(3)(3) on the grounds that in these circumstances the balance between the right to life of a woman and the unborn shifts in favour of the woman." So while the original point of the legislation is to protect the life of the unborn, there's a kind of a legal vacuum, a legal difficulty occurs where the unborn's life is not a viable prospect. Legislation states that the state's duty is to defend the rights of the unborn insofar as it is practicable. So non-viability clearly impacts on the practicability and the mother's rights under Articles 40 and 41 and Article 8 of the European Convention on Human Rights. So trying to balance these two lives, one of choice is in full and complete with of a life where one is full and complete with another, which due to tragically unfortunate circumstances has been or will be cut short, as in the cases of fatal fetal abnormality. That is not balance, but it's heaping misery on men, on women and on parents who deserve compassion and sympathy and care in those very difficult circumstances. There's an argument that, and I agree with it, this cannot be left to the legal profession. It has to be to the government to lead on this. We know that the Attorney General has advised that the bill is unconstitutional, but others disagree. Ms. Schwepp, who assisted in drafting the bill, and a quote from her, she says the state is under, under no obligation to force a woman to carry a pregnancy to term where there is no prospect of life. For those women and parents, the decision to terminate that pregnancy, knowing that the unborn will not survive outside the womb, is a decision that takes a lot of courage and strength. They have the right under Article the 13th Amendment to make the journey to the UK for termination, but these are Irish women. They're citizens of Ireland and they should not have to travel abroad. And forcing the woman to carry that unviable life to full term is cruel. In many cases, fetal complications can cause miscarriage, which in itself is going to lead to further health problems, never minding the whole experience of having to travel being traumatic. So in concluding, it's a very narrow remit to those unborn who cannot survive outside the womb. And it's about allowing women and parents whose unborn will not live outside the womb to have that termination in Ireland. It's about, as Deputy Daly said, it's about clarity for those in that very difficult situation. And I just find it a total contradiction that medical advice can be given about travelling to another jurisdiction for a termination, but yet that termination cannot be held in this country. I want to acknowledge all the work that Deputy Daly has done on this bill, and there is a need, a dire need, to look at this properly.
Thank you, Deputy.